Thank you for joining me in this exciting format. My name's Darren Griffin. I'm Professor of Genetics in this fine institution. What I thought I'd tell you about today was what I see as the 10 commandments of being a successful academic scientist. But before we get to that, those 10 commandments, one of the things I think it's quite important to think about is how would we know? How do we recognize a successful scientist? First of all, one of the things that people look at me a lot, and often the first question is, how much funding have you raised? How much money have you got? This is often the first thing that people will look at, not only in promotion criteria, but if you're looking for a new job in a particular area. Secondly, the publications. Academics have to publish. That's what we do. So, quality and quantity. How many papers have you published? By the usual metrics we look at with these things, what is the quality of them? Number three, and this is relatively new in comparison, it's only been around for the last 10 years, the research councils are thinking a lot more about what they call impact. What is impact? Well, I like to summarize that as the price of chips. So how does your research impact on society? Is it publicly accessible? Does it affect industry or public policy? Another thing that we looked at a lot is our graduate students. How many people have we trained, say, to PhD level? The question I'm asked most is how many or what proportion of your graduate students have submitted their thesis within 4 years of registration? How much have they published for each of their PhD theses? So we're also judged on our teaching. First of all, the degree of innovation. How innovative are we? And our student satisfaction. But if you remember nothing else from this talk, one of the things I'd like to get across to you is this. Perception is reality. It doesn't matter how good you think you are. It's how good you are perceived in the general community that is important. It's a little bit like being a dancer. You might be the best dancer in the world, but unless you get out and dance, no one will recognize you for being such. So, in my opinion, what are the best and most memorable scientists? What traits do they have? Well, first of all, I think they produce high quality and very readable papers, something that's interesting and makes you want to read it. They raise substantial funds for their work. They're good at persuading people to give them the funds to do their research. They're very good at team building. They build a group around them that are active, productive, and settled. The presentations that they give are interesting and they're very entertaining. And I'll leave you to judge whether this is a good example of that. They network in the scientific community. They talk to people. They're well known. The research they do is, yes, of high quality, but it's also relevant to society. They engage with the public. They actually get out there and talk about the work that they do and why it's interesting. They are good citizens. They make the machine of science work. Science requires a lot of administration. It requires the reviewing of grants and reviewing of papers in a fair and balanced way. They support and encourage their colleagues, regardless of how senior these colleagues are. So whether they're the most lofty professor or the most brand new graduate student, then we're all colleagues in science, and that's hugely important. And then finally, in inverted commas, they produce other scientists, their students, and their postdocs that have similar traits. One of the proudest things that I do in my job is see my students through and how they develop, and how they develop some of these traits that I've showed you. So, you might ask yourself, am I perceived to be a good scientist? Well, sometimes when I give this talk, I have a list of what I think my achievements are. I won't do that today, because really there is only one thing you need to know about me. I'm really not very intelligent. So, how do I get around that fact? What is my advice to you if you want to become a successful scientist, particularly if, like me, you're not the brainiest person in the world? Well, number one, top of the list, is this. There is only one good way to do good scientific research, and that is this. Just get on with it. Write that grant. Write that paper. Talk to your colleagues about new ideas. Get your students through their PhDs. Help them. But whatever you do, don't sit around thinking about it. Do it. Number two is all about opportunity. Opportunity will knock many, many, many times. And it astounds me the number of times you see people not taking advantage of that. So when opportunity knocks, it is important to open the door and see what's there. See if that opportunity is for you. In science, gone are the days where a lone scientist is sitting in their lab at midnight on their own doing nothing else. It is important to be able to build a team around you. And equally important that team, or there's individuals in that team, are better than you are at certain things, certain aspects of what you do. Because if you think about it, otherwise they're no good to you. If you can do it better and quicker, I'm hopeless with computers, but I have students who are incredibly good at programming. And so we get our heads together and we do what we do. Because with good people, you can do anything. You can achieve anything you like. Now, I mentioned to you a moment ago, please don't spread this around. I'm not all that knowledgeable. But I would argue it's not about your knowledge. It's about your imagination and your ideas and your team and your collaborative colleagues. Because we all know these days, if we want to find something out, we can turn to our smartphones and find it out almost immediately. So if you want knowledge, just go and look it up on the web. Always bring something to the party. If you want something, you're far more likely to get it if you offer something in return. So perhaps I can help you out with this, but would you mind doing this for me? I really need this doing, but perhaps I can get 90% of the way, can help you out because I need this from you. It makes a huge difference. Now this reference is to do with funding. So often there are very, very large, highly funded organizations with big guns, if you like. But often it's not about how much money there is there. Sometimes the time when you shoot. So it's when you shoot, because shooting wisely and efficiently and quickly might help you define the target. There will be many times in your career where the system will not work for you. Now, if you think about it, you only have three options. The first is to try and change that system. Work hard to make it change, or make it change for you at least. Secondly, you can walk away and do something else. But if neither of those are going to happen, there's really not a lot of point in complaining about it. If you can't change it and you can't do something else, what's the point in complaining? No one likes people that complain for no apparent reason. Science is full of rejection. You often get papers that are rejected and grants and so on. Of course, that is disappointing. You spend a lot of time asking why. Why does this happen? Why does this process the way it is? What evolutionary advantage is there? But often, when you get a little bit of rejection, then asking why not is the appropriate question. So can you tell me why I didn't get this grant? What was wrong with this paper? I really want to learn from it. I think perhaps this reviewer was mistaken in their view for these very factual reasons. So make a point of asking why not. It's your career, after all. Because taking no for an answer the first time isn't always the appropriate means of doing it. Every time you get a no, if you ask why not, and if you learn from that, it gets you closer to a yes the next time. And it's very, very easy to run after things yourself in comparison to try and encouraging people to chase you. Easier to chase than be chased. No one is going to walk in your office and get £1 million out of their pocket and give you the money in order to do your research. You've got to go after it. You've got to run after it. Now, I like to do a little bit of yoga from time to time. And this is a very yogic commandment. And that's this. You're on a journey. You're on a journey of discovery. I still am. I still like to go after many scientific questions. And often when you start in your PhD or a postdoc or as an early career researcher, then you're always on a journey. And of course, you often have a goal in mind, getting a grant, getting a paper, getting a PhD. But consider this. Often, the journey on which you are is more important than the destination, more enjoyable sometimes. So do enjoy the process because it's a lot of fun. And then finally, number 10, and I think this is perhaps the most important of all the commandments, is be nice to people. First of all, because it's the right and noble thing to do. But secondly, it's actually in your interest. It's to your advantage to do that. Because often, if people are, or if you're nice to people, they will be nice back to you. And if they're not, perhaps they're not worth bothering with in the first place. And on that note, I just thought I'd cheat with the Ten Commandments and just give you another one. Because sometimes when people aren't nice to you, there is a little bit of advice that I can give you. And I have to say, I'm not a Latin scholar. This isn't proper Latin. But if you look it up on Google, you might find what I'm on about. So, in conclusion of being a successful scientist, first, the only way to do good research is to get on with it. When opportunity knocks, open the door, see what's there. It might be important. Build yourself a team, because with good people, you can do anything. It's not about your knowledge. It's about your imagination and your ideas and your enthusiasm. Always bring something to the party. If you want something, offering something in return up front will often get you that a lot quicker and in a way that people find more rewarding and enjoyable. It's not the size of your gun. It's not always about having big bucks. Often it can be about judicious shooting, finding the right target, helping to define the target. The system may not work for you from time to time, and in which case you only have a few options. Don't ask why all the time. Sometimes ask why not. The yogic one, the journey. Enjoy the journey that you're on. And then finally, and most importantly, please, please, please be nice to people. My name's Darren Griffin. Thank you very much for listening.